ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। Reading Bhagavad Gita as it is, Chapter 11, The Universal Form, Text 1. Arjuna Vacha Mad Anugrahaya Paramang Guyam Adhyatma Sangjitang Yatva Yoktang Vachastena Mohoyam Vigato Mama. Arjuna Vacha Mad Anugrahaya Paramang Guyam Adhyatma Sangitam Yatva Yoktang Vachastena Mohoyam Vigato Mama. Arjuna Vacha Mad Anugrahaya Paramang Guyam Adhyatma Sangitam Yatva Yoktang Vachastena Mohoyam Vigato Mama. Arjuna Vacha. Arjuna said, Mat Anugrahaya. Just to show me favor. Paramam, supreme. Guyam, confidential. Confidential subject. Adhyatma, spiritual. Sangitam, in the matter of. Yat, what? Tvayam, by you. Uktam, said. Vacha, words. Tena, by that. Moha, illusion. Ayam, this. Vigata, is removed. Mama, my. Translation and purport is Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Arjuna said, by my hearing the instructions you have kindly given me about these most confidential subject, spiritual subjects, my illusion has now been dispelled. Responsively, we're all like Arjuna here. Arjuna said, by my hearing the instructions you have kindly given me about these most confidential spiritual subjects, my illusion has now been dispelled. Srila Prabhupada's purport. This chapter reveals Krishna as the cause of all causes. He is even the cause of the Mahavishnu from whom the material universes emanate. Krishna is not an incarnation. He is the source of all incarnations. That has been completely explained in the last chapter. Now, as far as Arjuna is concerned, he says that his illusion is over. This means that Arjuna no longer thinks of Krishna as a mere human being, as a friend of his, but as a source of everything. Arjuna is very enlightened and is very glad that he has such a great friend as Krishna. But now he is thinking that although He may accept Krishna as a source of everything, others may not. So in order to establish Krishna's divinity for all, he is requesting Krishna in this chapter to show his universal form. Actually, when one sees the universal form of Krishna, one becomes frightened like Arjuna. But Krishna is so kind that after showing it, he converts himself again into his original form. Arjuna agrees to what Krishna has several times said. Krishna is speaking to him just for his benefit. So Arjuna acknowledges that all this is happening to him by Krishna's grace. He is now convinced that Krishna is the cause of all causes and is present in everyone's heart as the Super Soul. Om Jnanate Marandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshuru Militam Jena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobishtang Stapitang Jena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Didati Swaha Padantikam. Arjuna said, by my hearing the instructions you have kindly given me about these most confidential spiritual subjects, my illusion has now been dispelled. So, Hare Krishna. We're hearing Arjuna speaking about his realizations. And this whole Bhagavad Gita is meant to snap us out of the illusion that we're living in. Everyone has a conception, bodily conception. All the animals and beasts, they're forced to think, I'm a dog, I'm a pig. They don't even think that, they just exist. Eating, sleeping, mating, defending. So human form of life, by Krishna's grace, he gives us special intelligence. And it's very difficult if we don't utilize our intelligence to awaken our self-realization, spiritual self-realization. So we're like swimming in an ocean, suffering, struggling, drowning over and over again. And it's like almost by great fortune that the ship, the ISKCON ship, and the captain, Srila Prabhupada, he's picking up all these drowning spirit souls, throwing life preservers, come on board. And he's hammering the philosophy, Dehi no smin yata dehe komaran yovinang jara tata dehantara praptir dhirastatram namuyati. The conditioned soul is going from boyhood to youth to old age. The body's always changing, but the soul remains the same. So that soul is identifying with Krishna. It has a relationship with Krishna. Sometimes there's arguments, how can a pure soul fall from the spiritual kingdom? But by hearing Prabhupada and understanding going back home, back to Godhead, it's like trying to explain some very scientific mathematical equation to a two-year-old. It doesn't matter, you know, whether we understand that we fell from the spiritual world, we were manifesting the Brahma Jyoti, that, you know, there are many arguments that can lead us off the path. We have a very, very broad path. And Krishna, in the form, well, Krishna and his representative, the spiritual master, Srila Prabhupada and Prabhupada's followers, they put a torchlight. Like if you're in complete darkness, many of you may have been in the woods. I like going up in the Himalayas on my motorcycle sometimes. I get in trouble. but it's you know, it could be very, very dark in the woods, especially if it's a cloudy evening. And so the light that's being given to us by Prabhupada is similar, I mean, is exactly the instructions which are coming from Krishna. Arjuna's hearing Krishna's instructions. You have given me these most confidential spiritual subjects. Now my illusion is gone. So we're praying, Om Ajnanate Marandasya Gyananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Jaina Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha. We're all born in ignorance. And we're all going, bouncing through the laws of karma. Many good things happen to us. Many bad things happen to us. You know, people claim, oh, I had a bad childhood. I was born in Europe. I came to America. My father took off. So basically, my mother and my brother, I couldn't speak English. They brought me to school the first day. I was totally lost. I had no idea which way to go, this way, that way. And you think, oh, here I am from a foreign country to a foreign land. And you're almost feeling all alone. And that's how we are in this material world. We're all alone. We're foreigners in a foreign land. And some may think that, oh, I've had a very rough childhood, bad upbringing, bad things happened to me, so I'm very disturbed, I'm mad at the world. Yes, we should be, in one sense, disgusted and disturbed by material existence. Because dukkhaliyam ashashvatam, material world is a place of misery and suffering. And we may think that, oh, some people are enjoying, you know, this one's going on a cruise, on a yacht, or living in a mountain, in a nice chalet, and this one has money and the beautiful things. You know, some people are enjoying, but it's all just like a drop on the lotus leaf. You shake the leaf and the drop falls off, it's finished. This life can be finished at any moment. Look at John F. Kennedy, young, handsome, beautiful wife, beautiful family, very powerful position, President of the United States, in a convertible on a sunny day in Dallas, Texas, waving at all his people cheering him and shot in the head and killed. So whether we live 10 years, 20 years, 50 years, 100 years, this life is totally temporary. So to get us out of the illusion, the confusion, that I have to work hard for this, I have to work hard to achieve so many goals in life. Yeah, you know, many of us have done that. I've had many businesses. I have a family, two sons. One's a policeman, detective, and the other one, you know, does nice business. It's not that we become lazy fellows. It's not that after Krishna instructed Arjuna, that Arjuna put the bow down and just kicked his feet up on the chariot and started, you know, just smoking some ganja and relaxing. Now there's nothing to do. No, he actually took up his bow, his arrow, and he fought the enemy. He actually did something. So we should utilize our human form of life, most importantly, to hear about Krishna. Hear Bhagavad Gita. Today I was going to give class, then Maharaj, Gopakrishna Maharaj called me, said, I'm coming, we have to discuss some cases. I said, but Maharaj, I'm giving class. He said, okay, well, cancel class. We have to discuss. I said, okay, I'm canceling class. Then he called, okay, I'm not coming. Okay, I'm coming, I'm not coming. So, you know, he just called again, said he's coming late. I said, okay, I have time for class. He goes, you have time for two classes. I said, okay, we'll give class. But it's not that, I was reading Bhagavad Gita today and I was appreciating Prabhupada put so much nectar and so much strength and power in this Bhagavad Gita. I was trying to read a little bit about the previous chapter, kind of just, you know, get in the mood of what is being discussed here, because obviously, you know, we want to discuss about Krishna, we want to discuss about our confusion, our illusions, and be grateful that Krishna is giving knowledge, and this knowledge is so valuable because Arjuna just felt totally enlivened, all so much enlivened that his illusion was gone. And that's our problem. We're living in illusion. We're living in darkness. we're not understanding the most important thing in life is to serve and love Krishna. So here we, not that we don't, because all of you are here in Vrindavan Dham, and we're hearing from Prabhupada, reading Prabhupada's books, Shravanam, Kirtanam, Vishnu, Smaranam, in the association of devotees in the most holy place in the universe. So this is to our good fortune, but we should do it with determination. Utsahan nishchayat taryat tat tat karma parvartanat. We need enthusiasm, determination, patience. Every day, make a plan that every day, I just thought, you know, I have to go now back to Florida and a little bit in New York, but I thought, I'd like to read a chapter a day of Bhagavad Gita. And if you do that, you know, have some commitments, or at least, you know, if you have a half an hour, if we look at our day, we have time for so many things. So if we can, with enthusiasm, say that out loud, I'm going to read Bhagavad Gita, I want to hear it, the vibration of Bhagavad Gita. Because this is coming from Srila Prabhupada, and Srila Prabhupada, when he's glorified, they say, oh Prabhupada, you speak so wonderfully, or you've done so many wonderful things. And Prabhupada says, I have no qualifications. I don't see myself as a great man. I just repeat the words of Krishna. Krishna speaking this confidential knowledge. Krishna's revealing this knowledge, making it available. He's speaking to Arjuna. The great teachers are speaking about it. The great yogis, the mystics. But Prabhupada has brought it and delivered in such a way so we can understand it. Because we have a difficulty because of people always think that they know, they don't need to hear from someone else. Someone asked me today for good advice. What's your advice? Is that we try to hear submissively. We hear something and don't think about how I'm going to answer immediately, or, you know, everyone thinks that they're right. The one that's right is Krishna, and Krishna's representative. And we have to try to mold our life to want to hear Bhagavad Gita, want to carry out this understanding. And if we're hearing Bhagavad Gita or reading it every day and read Bhagavatam, I know when I was in Miami, we used to do Sankirtan every day, go on Sankirtan. Before Sankirtan, we wanted to prepare ourselves for the battle, because when you go out to distribute books, meet the conditioned souls, you need to have some strength. And many times I'd have two or three books I'm reading, like, you know, maybe 20 minutes Bhagavad Gita, teachings of Queen Kunti, teachings of Lord Kapiladeva, Nectar of Instruction, Nectar of Devotion, Srimad Bhagavatam, and just all this Vedic literature that Vyasadeva has given us is giving us strength. Just like one who's sick takes medicine, or like many people when they work out ready for a battle, like fighters, they're running, they're watching what they eat, they exercise, they study the movements of the opponent to be ready for the battle. So we're in a battlefield, a battle with the senses, a battle with the mind, a battle with karmana daivana trena, the things that Mother Nature is throwing at us, the things that our mind is, you know, we all have a certain comfort zone that we want to try to live in. Arjuna was trying to find that comfort zone because he did not want to fight the battle. He saw his friends, he saw his relatives. He thought that by engaging in such a battle, I'm committing sin. What's the use of having such a kingdom when all my friends won't be there for me to appreciate or enjoy this kingdom? If I kill everybody in this battle, then I'm creating such a situation, I'm disturbing the family element, an unwanted population will come. He gave many very logical and good reasons why he didn't want to fight. So we have many reasons why we don't want to fight or maybe work harder to become Krishna conscious. Because Krishna consciousness is our most important duty. Once we have that realization, I'm sure all of you had this when you met devotees, when you read something, Srimad Bhagavatam, something gave you the spark to want to become Krishna conscious. And the feeling of, that I have a chance to stop this suffering and go back to the spiritual kingdom, becomes very enlivening. You start thinking, there's something beyond this, you know, bad knees and, you know, and I can't hear properly. We can see Krishna, he's a bit of a comedian. He gives a baby such a beautiful little cute body. Everyone's so attracted, you know. There's so many beautiful babies every morning we see them. And they become young boys and girls. Look nice. But after some time, 60, 70, 80 years old, things start slackening. Teeth start falling out. I have many friends, they have, you know, false teeth and hearing aids. What? You got to turn to the right ear to get to make sure they understand what you're saying. So our life is passing us, and Krishna's teaching that don't waste this human form of life. If you, Prabhupada, during a lecture, is speaking that, okay, here we are in Vrindavan, maybe it's 6:05, I'm not sure if that clock is right. It's Saturday night, 6:05. Now, when it becomes 6:06, we can't get 6:05 back, it's gone. And even if you're ready to pay millions of dollars, you can't get that time back, it's past, it's gone. So, imagine one very, very wealthy man, Prabhupada tells a story in either Bombay or Calcutta, I forget. The doctor told him, you're dying, that's it, you know, you've got maybe, you know, 1 month left. Doctor, can't you give me 4 more years to finish my plans? And it doesn't matter whether you're a wealthy man and have millions and billions of dollars, when it's time to go, it's time to go. So we should have this faith, and we do, because we're trying to take up this process of Krishna consciousness seriously. We should apply our energy to hearing about Krishna, rendering service to Krishna, rendering service to Srila Prabhupada. It's not that we're worshippers of man or just a cult, although many times they say the Chaitanya cult. It's the cult word is used in a negative way, but this is a cult with the Supreme Lord, the Supreme Person. And if you're genuinely on the right path, many people think they're on the right path, but we have authentic literature, very philosophical, very clear, easy to understand. It's not that someone charismatic person is speaking some mystic philosophy, and because he looks cool, he's got a nice, you know, nice dress or beard, and we think, wow, you know, Gurudev, Jai Gurudev. Yes, Jai Gurudev. And the guru, guru is one who understands and delivering the message of Krishna. Kiba vipra kiba nashi shudra kene noi ye Krishna tattva veta se guru hoy. He's a guru who's delivering the knowledge of Krishna, who's repeating the words of Krishna. Prabhupada said, if you want to speak nicely, you have to hear nicely. So imagine if daily, if we can come to that point, 1 hour, 2 hours, reading Bhagavatam out loud, reading Gita out loud, hearing it, and really try applying our mind and our heart to understand it. because I was reading something in the Bhagavatam, and I know I've read it before, but it's, God, how did I forget all that? That's such nice nectar there. And it's so beautifully presented how Krishna expands himself to Narayan and Narayan in the form of many, many expansions. Come to Mahavishnu, lies in a huge ocean, and just by breathing, unlimited universes are coming from his body. It's like, wow, you guys are really far out. But God is great. The Lord is creating unlimited universes from his lying in the causal ocean. And then he expands himself and enters into each universe. Garbhodakshay Vishnu. And then while in each universe, from his navel sprouts a lotus, Lord Brahma, the first created being. And from Lord Brahma, so many of the demigods, all the demigods are coming. But it says that Krishna is the creator, but indirectly. So we're seeing that in each universe, the Lord is creating a Brahma, and Lord Brahma, with his power of meditation and tapasya, tapa, tene brahma hridaya adhikavaye muyanti yat suryaha. So Krishna, in the heart of Brahma, is revealing this knowledge. He saved the Vedas, because the Vedas, I am the Vedas, Vedaischa sarvair aham eva veja. Krishna is the Vedas. Veda means knowledge, so Krishna is the source of knowledge. Krishna creates Brahma, he gives Brahma the Vedas. And then Brahma gives to Narada Muni to Vyasadeva, Madhvacharya, down, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Bhaktisiddhanta, the Guru Parampara. It's a very clear, distinct, disciplic succession. Evang parampara praptam imang rajarshayo vidhu. So this knowledge of Veda, of the goal and the perfection of life, is coming from Krishna to Brahma. And Krishna's in the heart of every living being. Sarvasya chahang hridi sanavishto matak smritir jnanam apohanam cha. He expands himself again into every atom. I don't know if you've ever seen the sunlight coming through a screen, and you see all these tiny particles everywhere. And those are not, and those are even much bigger than atoms. So what the naked eye can see, you can see all these little tiny particles. So Krishna's everywhere throughout this whole creation, but he's he's in personal form. And he sees what we're wanting, what we desire. And by seeing the desire, Krishna's guiding us. Somebody wants to stay and enjoy the material illusion of life, Krishna allows it, because this is freedom, this is love. But if someone is fortunate enough to see that there is no real happiness, there is no real satisfaction in this material existence, Krishna, I want you. My dear Lord, I have fallen to this ocean of birth and death. Please pick me up from this ocean of suffering. Engage me as one of your servants. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu gives us all the prayers. This Shikshashtika, if we read Chaito Darpana Marjanang Bhava Mahadevagni Nirvapanang Shreya Kairava Chandrika Vitaranang Vijavadhu Jivanam, clean the heart, chant the Lord's holy name. And all potency is there in his holy names. So Krishna, he's still speaking. It's not that he spoke to Arjuna and now Krishna stopped speaking. Krishna's in our heart, and Krishna wants to speak if we want to hear. It's like you don't want to speak to someone who doesn't want to hear you. Or we may be speaking, but someone's not listening. You feel a little bit offended, so you think, why bother speaking? He's not hearing me anyway. So if we're not hearing Krishna, then Krishna says, I'm here. When you want to listen, I will speak. And Krishna is speaking, and now we're hearing. We have a lucky moment here. We're all fortunate enough to hear something about Arjuna's appreciation of all the knowledge, confidential knowledge. And it's like when you read each chapter, you think, how can it get any better? How much deeper can it go? But it's like we're so entangled and so covered by layers of anger, lust, greed, illusion, that it takes some time. I don't know if you like, sometimes you have some brass item and it's really, really tarnished. And you got to put the lemon and whatever other things they use, and you got to just rub it and rub it and rub it and rub it. And then finally, all the tarnish starts coming off. We sometimes see the deity paraphernalia, all devotees are there rubbing, and then it starts glowing and shining. So we've been covered by thick layers, which has become very crustified. It's like that. It's like a complete covering of our consciousness, the illusions of lifetime of desires, of hate, lust, envy, you know, just really struggling in this world to try to find that happiness, that ultimate happiness, which is only available by going back home, back to our home. People may be on go for vacations. They go here, they go there, stay with these people, stay with those people, and stay at a hotel. But when you finally get home, when you feel like, oh, I'm in my home, you know, I don't think about anything, then you could kind of really let down your guard and relax. So Krishna's trying to bring us back home, back to the spiritual kingdom. And that kingdom is being described as Chintamani Dham. Surabhi calls Krishna, he comes and performs his confidential pastimes. He's playing with the cowherd boys. We're seeing Radha Shyama Sundalita Vishaka. We're hearing the stories of how Srimati Radharani appears, how Krishna appears, Nanda Maharaj, Yashoda, Mayi. And we're hearing now many beautiful pastimes in Bhagavatam about Jai and Vijay, Hiranyaksha, Hiranyakashipu. Some of these stories are incredible. They're very mystical stories. And the stories of Bhagavatam and the Mahabharata and the great history of India just shows that the material world just continues going on and on and on, and there's always a fight, isn't it? There's always a good fight going on. You know, this one conquers that one, and the war of 1812, the World War I, World War II, waiting for World War III, Korean War, Vietnam War, the Cold War. the British took over this and that and everything else, the Persians took over that, and the Hindu Muslims, and thousands of years and hundreds of thousands of years and millions of years, Ravana and Lord Ramchandra. And we may think that, well, you know, some of those stories are a little bit extravagant. But for our limited understanding, what do we know what took place millions of years ago? What kind of mystic powers were available in the different ages? We see some people have some powers, and we're impressed. We go to a circus and somebody's levitating, or somebody might have some ability to produce some gold, or, you know, there's a lot of different powers available. And being in Kali Yuga, the powers that we're exhibiting are very tiny. But in other ages, they had the mystic powers of transforming their bodies into different forms. You know, like the demons, all the different demons that were aligned with Kamsa, they were taking different forms. They were exhibiting mystic powers. And so Krishna, he's giving full facility. He's not limiting what you can do in this world. You could become a great demigod. You become a little ant, little cockroach, and be crushed, you know? Spider, fish, we have some pretty cool fish in Prabhupada's pond there. So even Prabhupada, I was supposed to read this morning from today's date, Prabhupada said about people are very liking very much the swimming and the ocean like the fish. But Krishna is very kind. You can become a fish in your next life. No problem. You can become whatever you want. Yang vapi smaram bhavam tyajat yante kalevaram. Whatever state of being one remembers when he quits his body, that state he'll attain without fail. So we want to embed in our mind, in our heart, the Krishna sound vibration, the chanting of Krishna's name, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. And by chanting Krishna's name and sounding that vibration, it's like the cleansing of the brass, cleansing of the dirty heart, awakening of our spiritual emotions, spiritual strength. Bala means strength, and without spiritual strength, it's very difficult. Arjuna said, Krishna, are you kidding me? How am I going to control this mind? It's more difficult to control than a raging wind. I was managing the temple in Miami Beach for many years there. And in Miami, sometimes the wind would come, you know, off the ocean, heavy wind. The palm trees would all be bending. There's a lot of hurricanes down in the south, and we always prepare for hurricane season. I've been through a few hurricanes. Heavy wind, you can't put up any, you know, your hands or try to control the raging wind. So the mind is like a raging wind. How am I going to control this crazy mind? I'm just so disturbed, you know. This person's agitating me, that person, this situation disturbs me. You know, so many disturbing elements are there. Sometimes I think, okay, I've been 4 months in India, they're blowing their horn, I'm going to kill the next person who blows his horn. You know, it's like, I'm getting I'm not controlling myself, because if the next person who cuts me off, okay, we're all in line, we're all waiting, and somebody just zips. I said, you know, there's a line here, get back in line. You know, it's frustrating being in this world, not only here, I'm sure it's frustrating in many places. But to control that, Arjuna was saying, Krishna, how is it possible? But Krishna was giving indication that, okay, with constant practice, detachment, it's almost like you find an impossible situation, and then the clouds disperse, the sun shines in. It's like, wow, how did that happen? Sometimes on Sankirtan, I work in New York sometimes, police are coming down, the supervisor of security, that's it, you guys are finished here, you can't do it. And then I started thinking, oh my God, you know, my Sankirtan spot's closing down, how is it all gonna... And then somehow or other, Krishna arranges some changes, and how did I get out of that difficult situation? So we have to have faith. I've been on the streets for many years doing Sankirtan. And not that I'm boasting about it, but the point is that many times it'd be very difficult because meeting people, trying to stop them, giving them a book, and try to convince them that this is a good idea, that you should take the book, this, you know, purify the mind, elevate the consciousness, and give a donation for a good cause, you know? It's like, whatever you want to, however you want to make a beautiful wisdom from the ancient writings. It's very limited what they can really assimilate or appreciate. But this is beautiful wisdom from the ancient writings. Gandhi, Thoreau, Emerson, many great personalities appreciated Bhagavad Gita. Help us understand how to purify the mind, elevate the consciousness, understand the purpose and goal in life. Not that you say all those things, maybe just even one of those things. But some days, due to my own mind or disturbances, I feel like when you look at people, they say, I don't want to talk to you. You know, the people pick up the vibration. There's a certain, how you say, you give me a bad vibe. And then you might struggle for hours with your own mind, with your own feelings of inability, your own feelings of I'm useless, you know. I have no ability to do this. And then I have no choice. I pick up Prabhupada's books and read a few, whatever book I'm distributing, I'll read a page. And then try again. And then somehow something clicks and nobody can say no. And people look at, say, I want to hire you. You know, you're really charismatic personality, or you've got so much energy. What is it you're selling? What is it you're giving? Krishna consciousness. Even a priest told Prabhupada that these are our boys from the Christian, Catholic, Jewish background, and now they're so bright-faced and so happy. What is it that you're doing to them? So I had the realization when I thought that, well, today's going to be a complete useless washout. Krishna turns it around. I say 99.99% of the time, I felt at the end of the day, wow, how did that happen? As Krishna's special potency, special mercy. So this is what Arjuna is experiencing here. He said, wow, after hearing all these incredible instructions, very confidential spiritual wisdom, I feel like I'm out of illusion. And it may not be in a snap, but look at Dhruva Maharaj. After great determination, 6 months, small boy, he achieved such a high platform. And we're not going to judge things that, okay, how much time before I become a pure devotee? What do you think? You know, 10 years, 100, like Prabhupada tells the story of the Brahmana. Narada Muni, where are you going? I'm going to Vaikuntha. Oh, ask the Lord when my liberation will come. Then the cobbler, a very simple person, not a very high post. Naradaji, where are you going? Vaikuntha. Ask the Lord when I'm getting liberation. So Narada Muni meets the Lord, and he's going back now, and he asks, my Lord, when will this Brahmana achieve liberation? They were very curious, wanted to know. Oh, the Brahmana, it will take some time. You have to continue working at it. The cobbler, when's this cobbler coming? Oh, he's coming back next lifetime. So Narada Muni is a little astonished that the Lord, he has such conclusion. And Narada said, thank you. And Narayan, the Lord, Krishna said, if they ask what's our Lord doing in Vaikuntha, you tell them, I'm threading an elephant through the eye of a needle. You know, sometimes you try to put that thread through the needle so you can sew. So Krishna is putting the elephant through the eye of a needle. So the Brahmana sees Narada Muni. Oh, Narada Ji, Hare Krishna. How was your visit to Vaikuntha? Excellent. You know, the Lord is very beautiful and everything's wonderful. What was my Lord doing in Vaikuntha? The Lord was putting an elephant through the eye of a needle. Oh, Narada Ji, you're such a jokester. You're telling so many stories. These are such big stories you're telling, you know, like I can't believe such a story. Then Narada Muni understood that he really doesn't have the faith that Krishna can put the elephant through the eye of the needle. And he goes to the cobbler. Cobbler offered respect. My dear Narada, again he asked, what is my Lord doing? Putting an elephant through the eye of a needle. Oh, my Lord is so incredible, so wonderful. He can do anything. Narada Muni questioned, how is it that you're accepting or believing such a fantastic pastime of the Lord? And he gave the example of a banyan tree. Every day I'm sitting and so many fruits are falling, and from the seeds of this fruit, so many unlimited banyan trees are coming out just from the little seeds. And he's thinking, Krishna, he's just so remarkable. How is it that just by a little seed comes into a huge banyan tree, produces hundreds and thousands of another seeds, they produce other banyan trees? It's like, wow, he's such mystical potency. He can do anything. And Narada Muni understood that this devotee has great faith in Krishna. He believes that the Lord can do anything. And Krishna can do anything. He can free us in a moment from our illusion. He can give us Divya Gyan, transcendental knowledge. But it's not like we're thinking, well, why doesn't he do it? Why doesn't he give it to us? Because we're still holding on to all our desires, isn't it? We still have our identities. And, I'm pursuing Krishna consciousness, but I still need my little, comfort zone to feel satisfied. And that's understandable. And we're trying to maybe gradually get more and more serious and more dedicated, because if there's a pinch of material desire, we have to come back to the material world. And we're hoping, because of the beautiful and wonderful realizations and power of the holy name, we're hoping that it can propel us much, much closer to Krishna's lotus feet. And that even though we think that I'm never going to get over my desires, I'm not going to get over my crazy mind and senses, how am I going to get to the point of becoming a pure soul like Srila Prabhupada and Mahabhagavat? There's so many pure devotees. How can I become a pure devotee? I'm just confused jiva soul in this material world. But Krishna, I guess the story of Hanuman and the warrior monkeys and the small spider, or whoever was helping, was a squirrel something, many different pastimes. Everyone's helping the Lord according to their capacity. So we should utilize our capacity to want to hear about Krishna and want to follow the order of our spiritual master, because there's potency in that order. We're reading the Sangsara Dava prayers, that we're cleaning the temple of the devotees, chanting, dancing, offering artik, observing special celebrations, and we're associating with devotees, we're smelling the tulsi, the flowers, we're taking the lamp, we're eating tulsi, taking prasadam. So we're taking medicine in many forms, and it's very, very powerful, and it can actually immediately liberate us. But we have to have enough strength to let go of those anchors. One last story of the bridal party. They're in the boat. They're all going to go to the next village. It's very dark. And everyone's very excited. We're going to go to the bridal party, and the boatman is all night rowing. In the morning, they say, we haven't gone anywhere. Oh, we forgot to take out the anchor. So although we're chanting and reading and associating and trying, making our own little endeavors, it's not by our endeavors, by the grace of God, but God helps those who help themselves. As you sow, so shall you reap. As they surrender unto me, I reward them accordingly. So we're all trying to surrender in our own capacity, but we have to take the anchor out so that when we're rowing, we make some progress towards the spiritual kingdom. And sometimes they say one step forward, two steps backwards. So we want to do two steps forward, maybe one step backward. Okay, so we're at least making some progress. And let's not create our own ideas. Arjuna was having so many ideas and so many suggestions, but then ultimately he came to the conclusion that it's not by my own ideas that I'm going to become Krishna conscious. We should understand that Prabhupada clearly is seeing Krishna, understanding Krishna, and he's understanding the Guru Parampara, the great Acharyas, and he's giving us Krishna consciousness. And it's not an old-fashioned process. Coming to the temple, seeing the devotees, chanting with the devotees, hearing Bhagavatam, hearing Bhagavad Gita, and trying to have this kind of determination that Arjuna had, is what's going to actually take us out of the suffering condition and give us enthusiasm and feeling of, yes, I'm part of Krishna consciousness. I feel like my illusion is subsiding to some degree. Sometimes it comes and captures us, the illusions of the material existence. But at least we're recognizing, we're seeing, we know when we're in Maya. We know when we're having a difficult day. And when we feel so good after hearing and chanting about Krishna, chanting the holy name. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So usually we end at 6:30. So quick question maybe? Yes, Prabhu? There's a microphone? I don't know. Yes, make
just
a point.
Just like Bhagavad Gita is just like a time bomb, Prabhupada said. So it explodes in our heart. So it explodes me in my heart and we came to Krishna consciousness. So similar way, I have one suggestion. I don't know whether I am correct or not. So in the temple, everywhere, we should have this speakers and going on Bhagavad Gita reciting so devotees can hear Krishna speaking and also the visitors who are coming, they can hear the Bhagavad Gita. It's completely whole day reciting is going on. Mm-hmm. So this is my suggestion. If you can do this, it's much better and many people will get benefit also. And even devotees can benefit because they will be hearing Krishna. Sometimes they are engaged in so many service, they cannot read Bhagavad Gita or Bhagavatam. Yeah. But I read Bhagavad Gita. I sit with Bhuvaneshwar Prabhu 1 hour every day. I read with him and also in my room I read Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavatam also. So, I have a suggestion if you can forward this one.
Good idea. I know that during Kartik, I was appreciating there's a kirtan going out. You know, we have a nice kirtan in the very front entrance inside of Prabhupada's Samadhi Mandir, in the main temple, in the Balaram Hall, in the Krishna Hall, in MVT. You know, so it's like the kirtan, the glorification of the name. And most of the time when our technology is not down, there's sometimes kirtan or lectures all day online and this and that. Of course, these are all great ideas and how to implement them because we have like so many visitors coming all the time. And we're actually servants of Srila Prabhupada to deliver Krishna consciousness to as many conditioned souls as possible. So we have them chanting in the samadhi and somebody also wanted to put Gita shlokas all around the temple. So I'm trying to put pictures, paintings. You see, we're always having the various paintings. So this is wonderful. Always hearing Gita, always thinking about Krishna, always having the chanting. Let's see if Krishna can give us intelligence how to do that. Thank you. Jai. Anyone else have any bright ideas? Here's a microphone. I'm one of these old guys that I play drums, and so my hearing is bad sometimes. Yeah, hit the switch. It's like, I think once, it reminds me of a story when one devotee was complaining to Srila Prabhupada. Prabhupada, in the temple there's so much Maya around, you know, so much Maya. And Prabhupada said, you show us that place, there's no Maya, we shall all go there. So it's a struggle that you're not alone in, you know, and we all know when we're falling short or maybe sometimes not acting to the highest platform of Krishna consciousness. What happens on the roadway when you slip and fall off the road? You get back on the road and continue moving forward. Not that we're saying, oh, it's okay to slip, or, you know, it's okay to, you know, give in once in a while, so then tomorrow will be a better day, you know, we'll feel stronger. That may not be the proper idea. Of course, sometimes we've seen in Christianity people that, you know, they whip themselves for, you know, being bad or thinking bad things or doing bad things. And it's okay to see to see our shortcomings, our faults, but Prabhupada's trying to instill in us the integrity or the good qualities of a brahmana, that you've made a commitment in front of the fire, in front of the devotees, you're making a vow. So it's like Vyavasta Yatmika Buddhi Reke Hakuru Nandana Bahushaka Hyanantas Chabudayo Vyavasayanam, that devotee, he has determination, he's fixed on his determination, whereas others, Bahushaka, whose mind is disturbed by so many other things, they lose focus, they lose track. So just stay focused on the goal that I want to become strong in Krishna consciousness. When those cloudy moments come and cover the sunshine of Krishna consciousness, you have to tolerate, apply your intelligence, seek good association. Sometimes we're depressed or feeling in a bad way. We need to have encouragement, or, you know, that you want to sometimes, so stay in good association and continue following the process. And as your strength increases more and more, one day you can tackle those dark moments. Okay. Thank you very much. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Hare Krishna.